Well, good morning, everybody. How we doing? All right, that's awesome. Well, I'm so glad all you guys are here. We are in week two of a three-part series called The Art of Neighboring, Love Where You Live. And if you didn't know this, churches all across Austin are involved with this series. In fact, Shoreline, Austin Stone, Gateway, Hill Country Bible Church, and then all the small churches. We're all on the same page on this one because we have this kind of passion to reach the city. In fact, all the big church pastors about 10 years ago got together with the mayor. And they asked the mayor, what is one thing that we could do if the church got unified, the church got all on the same page, what's the one thing that we could do to help or bless our city? And the mayor's response to that was really interesting. It was, we need to create a space for great neighbors. I need neighbors to know each other. And so it took about 10 years for us to figure out what that might look like, which is really kind of sad. But here we are, right? And we've been going through this series, The Art of Neighboring, because we've been saying this one thing. Because this is kind of what Jesus talked about. He was asked, how do I inherit eternal life? And Jesus kind of responded, well, I don't know. How do you read it to this scribe or this lawyer guy who knew his Bible really well? And he said, well, here's what the Bible says. Love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your strength and with all your soul and with all your mind and your neighbor as yourself. And so, and Jesus is like, that's right. Do this and you'll live. And so Jesus gives us our marching orders. Love God. I think we're all on board with that. Like, if you're here, maybe you're checking it out. Maybe you're like, okay, I at least know that the people that I came with or the people that I'm checking out, they love God. We just sang three songs this morning about how much we love God. In fact, after this, we'll sing two more about how much we love God. That is kind of what we do here. We sing songs about God and how much we love Him. But that's not it. God calls us also to love our neighbor. In fact, which was really interesting, last week we talked about this, the guy looks at Jesus and he's like trying to justify himself, but really, who is my neighbor? And you've asked that question because you've looked at your next door neighbor and be like, oh man, the guy that doesn't ever mow his lawn. And I've got to love him. The guy that, you know, there's irritating things about our neighbors and there's irritating things about you, and they probably think the same thing about you. And so, like, the reality is we all have neighbors and we are the neighbor. Probably somebody's like, oh gosh, the guy's singing in the backyard again. Like, that's probably me. Like, I mean, it's kind of awkward. I was wondered why my behind-the-house neighbors turned up the volume on the music they were playing. It was probably because I was singing. It was one of those awkward moments. You know, like, you guys ever do this when you're in a car and somebody starts singing and you're like, anyway, that's what it sort of felt like. Anyway, but like, that's what happened. So God has called us to love our neighbors. And by neighbor, I mean your actual neighbor, like literal neighbor. And we're going to be to show compassion on them. That's what we talked about last. We want to show compassion, but you can't show compassion if you don't know who they are. And so I gave you a task last week. Do you guys remember this task? Hopefully, it's a whole new crowd this week, I guess. We gave you this task, and I gave everybody one of these. Hopefully, you still have this. All right. In fact, if you don't have one of these, like at all, if you have no idea what I'm talking about, raise your hand in the air, and a usher will bring you one of these. Like, you need one of these. And hopefully, just keep them up for like 30 minutes or so, and eventually they'll get to you. Here's what we need. We need to know our neighbor's name so that we can have compassion on them, right? Like these are all my neighbors. Because I knew I'd be doing this sermon series, I was like, I got to at least know their name because I'd be really pretty hypocritical for the pastor to show up and not know who any of his neighbors are. So here I am. I know my neighbor's names. But I don't know anything beyond maybe like their religious preference or where they go to church or what, you know, kind of where they're at. And so I'm, over the next course of the next several months, I'm going to try and invest in them even more. And I really got convicted on this. And here's why I got convicted. I got convicted because I have I've got my eight neighbors in the eight immediate houses directly around me, but one house over. So I've got, to my right is Paul and Liz Saucedo. They're first service champions. They help set up every week. We love them. And next door to them is Craig and Tasha. And a couple weeks ago, Craig and Tasha came up to Adrian and I, and like when we were outside playing with Austin in the swing or something, and they're like, "Hey, we're moving." And we're like, "Well, oh, that's sad. Why are you moving?" And what Craig said, like, it was like the worst thing you could ever say to a pastor who's about to do an Art of Neighboring series, okay? He goes, "You know what? We just don't really feel connected to our neighborhood. We want to meet our neighbors. We just don't really know anybody here. Their kids are like our kids' age. They have two boys about 20 months apart. Like, you know, they live two doors down, and they go, yeah, we just don't really know anyone. We don't feel connected. We don't feel like, you know, this is a, I mean, this is Wells Branch, for crying out loud. It doesn't get much better than Wells Branch. I mean, for those of you who live in Wells Branch, this is kind of amazing." Yeah, you can clap for Wells Branch, yeah. So, like, but here they are in Wells Branch, the most neighborhood-friendly place on the planet, and they're going, we don't really know anybody, and nobody wants to be our friends. And I'm sitting there going, well, crud. All right, don't tell that story. You know what I mean? Like, that was kind of an awkward moment. And I sat there and I go, what happened? Like, I really wanted to reach out to Craig and Tasha and their boys Parker and Spencer, but you get busy. I mean, and, you know, they both work. You know, their kids are in daycare, so I couldn't, like, send, like, Adrian and, like, the mom train over there and, like, they hang out all day. And that wouldn't work. And so we kind of had to, I was sitting there, like, the hours that they sort of were free and that they would hang out outside. They were not, like, hide in their house people. They were out every day from 5 to 6. Well, my world from 5 to 6 is complete chaos. Anybody know what I'm talking about? I have a 2-year-old, 8-month-old, okay? You get home, and Adrian's like, here. And I'm like, you know, it's like, we're done, right? We're done. And so, like, that's kind of how it is. And so it's like, it's exhausting. And so how do we even work that in? How do we do that? And so I wanted this morning to kind of get a proper perspective on time. Because guess what? We all have time limits. But this is not surprising to anybody. But if we are going to reach our neighbor, if we are going to love our neighbor as ourselves, because, like, Jesus said so, or whatever, we've got to figure out a way to work that in with time. And so we don't have conversations with people who are our next-door neighbor going, like, yeah, I'm moving out. I just don't really know anybody. So here we go. We're going to be in, we're going to be working through Psalm 90. And so if you don't have a Bible, raise your hand in the air, and a Bible will come to you. And if you still haven't gotten your Art of Neighboring little tic-tac-toe board, you can raise your hand again for that. We're in Psalm 90, where Moses is going to be writing. And he's going to be writing to us about time. Because for a lot of us, our time, we pride ourselves on being busy. In fact, in America, our culture is all about being busy. You feel good about yourself if you're busy. Single people, come on, be real. If you're not busy on a Friday night or a Saturday night, there's panic. FOMO sets in. You start checking Facebook. You start checking, like, Instagram. You're like, all right, where are they at? Where are they at? And why didn't they call me? Like, we do that, right? And then also, we kind of, because of, like, our culture and the way we work, and I've done this my entire life, I feel bad if I'm not doing something at all times. And, like, if someone says something to me of, like, Chris, I'd like to meet with you. If I can't, because I have to do, like, sermon preparation, I go, I'm sorry, I'm busy. Now, I'm sitting in my office, like, probably just staring at the ceiling, thinking. But I have to make an excuse of, I can't say I'm sitting in the office staring at the ceiling thinking, because you're going to think, oh, well, that's perfect time for me to drop in. And it's not. So I have to make up the excuse of, I'm busy, right? I have to say I'm busy. And then all of a sudden, we kind of create a culture of how busy we are. And you're at work, and you're busy, and we tell our neighbors how busy we are. And then they feel like, well, I can't really talk to you because you're so busy. Virtue equals busy in our culture. We kind of hold it up right there with, like, not cheating on your taxes, not cheating on your spouse, being busy. And so what the only way that we're going to be able to reach our neighbors, I'm just going to be honest with you, it's in the margins. It's when we have time in the margins. And what's margin? It's the space between our current pace and our limits. And here's the truth. Here's the truth. We run at absolute Mach speed all the time, and you double book. Don't tell me you don't. I know you do. Because you have to, because someone's going to cancel on you because they're double booked. And this is why on airplanes, okay, when I was on an airplane yesterday, and they overbooked the flight. Why? Because they know someone's going to cancel. Because something else is going to come up they didn't think about. Oh, my gosh, something's going to happen, and they got to cancel. And so we are overwhelmed with too much. We are going past our limits. And so we understand this with, like, well, for example, space. A lot of you have a garage that doesn't have cars in them. It's got boxes and stuff, right? Okay, it is what it is. You park in the driveway, and your garage is like your storage facility. Like, public storage and you are like one and the same. It's just like, here's my sweet garage, and boom. And then when we run out of space in the garage, that's when we hit over public storage. So building public storage is like all over the place because we don't understand space limits. Okay, a lot of us don't understand budget, like money limits. That's why we max out credit cards and we live in a world of like debt. That's just kind of how we roll. And like, you know, we're in debt to our eyeballs, and we're like, well, you know, what's a couple hundred extra bucks, and we're constantly panicking when rent is due, all right? So that's kind of the reality that a lot of us live in, is we are always living beyond our limits, not only with time, but with a whole bunch of other stuff. So today we're going to focus on time just for today, because when you don't have time, you can't have a conversation with your neighbor. You do the wave, you pull in the garage door, and then you close it while you're still in your car. Not saying I've done that, but maybe I have several times. Okay, so like we're all in the same boat. We all are maxed out on time. We're all maxed out on everything. So I want us to have a proper perspective on time. And Moses, of all people, is going to give that to us starting in Psalm 90. And it's on page 496 in the Bible that we were passing out. In fact, if you don't know anything about Moses, like if you're like first time to church ever, Moses is kind of like sort of famous in like Bible world. And his life started out being born a Hebrew when, in that day, it wasn't popular to be a Hebrew. In fact, you were killed off if you were born as a Hebrew person in Egypt. And to save Moses' life, Moses' mom put him in the Nile River with a sweet little basket made out of reeds and some tar stuff. Somehow it floated. And it floated down to Pharaoh's daughter, and she picks it up. She's like, oh, baby. And like she's like, I'm going to take it home. I can collect these. You know, rich people have that kind of issue. And then she's like, well, where can I find someone to nurse this kid? Because, you know, I just want to have a fun little thing to play with. And so then, you know, Moses' mom comes along. She nurses her own son and lives in the palace. It was pretty much a sweet gig. So if you ever get stuck in that position, that's what you do. And then he lives 40 years. I mean, he's got plasma TVs. He drives, you know, the Ferrari Camel version. He's got a Tesla Camel. I mean, he's got like, and then he kind of notices that there's some little abuse going on out there in the slave world. And he's kind of been, you know, he's been living the party lifestyle. And he's, you know, he comes out, checks it out. He's like, man, this is kind of terrible. And he sees an Egyptian abusing one of the slaves, and he kills him. Word gets out. Moses just murdered somebody. And he heads off, east of Cairo, and heads off to like a desert area, and he just starts raising sheep. So he went from like sweet parties on the weekends with the rave scene, busting it up with some like sweet glow fire candles, and then he's out there with some sheep. All right, let's bring him in. Sheep, come on out. And his days were really full of nothing. A lot of days of staring at sheep in a field. And for 40 years he did that. All right, and it's like time to retire. He's 80 years old, and he thinks, that's about it. Had a couple kids, and you know, I'm gonna have some grandkids. They might remember Moses, but after that, it's donezo. I'm gonna, you know, pack it in. I'm gonna be buried out here next to my favorite sheep, Sammy. I don't know. Him and Sean the sheep hanging out. I don't know. So like what happened is like that's over. But then God comes to Moses in a burning bush. And so, if, you know, this is just FYI. If you're ever out, you know, in a field somewhere and there's like this bush that's burning, but it's not actually burning and it starts talking to you, could be God. And so anyway, the bush tells him that God is there, and like he's going to go and set his people free from Pharaoh. So Moses has another chapter of his life. He goes to Pharaoh, and he's like, let my people go. And Pharaoh's like, no. And he's like, well, check out some plagues. He's got frogs, locusts, like, you know, blood river. I mean, it was kind of crazy. And after 10 plagues, the last one pretty extreme, Pharaoh lets the people go. 2 million Israelites parade out of Egypt to the promised land. They must have made a wrong turn somewhere. They end up at the Red Sea, and then the Egyptians are upset, and they want to kill them all. Then Moses does a sweet thing, like puts a staff in the ground. God parts the Red Sea. They walk across, kill the Egyptians. All right, you guys remember this story? And then for the next 40 years, they walk in circles. So 40 years, like, living, like, this sweet lifestyle, 40 years of being bored, and then 40 years dealing with a lot of whiners and complainers, all right? So, like, that was kind of his life, and so here's a guy who knows something about time, and he's going to give us a perspective here about it, because I think sometimes we miss out on perspective, because our life, it's hard to have perspective when you're in it, when you're in, like, the craziness of your life, and you're busy, and you double booking, and then you got to cancel on somebody, and you feel sort of bad about it, but not really, because you got happened to you once, and then you keep moving. So I want to give you just for a second, we're going to breathe, and we're going to listen to Moses talk about time. Psalm 90, verse 1, Lord, you have been our dwelling place in all generations. Before the mountains were brought forth, or ever you had formed the earth and the world, from everlasting to everlasting, you are God. And here's what that means. Put a direction in time that way, God is all the way over there, infinity. To everlasting that way, God is all the way over there. I mean, he spans the breadth of time. He is everlasting to everlasting. You return man to dust and say, return, O children of man, you mortals, return to the dust I made you from. For 1,000 years in your sight are but as yesterday, when it is past, or as a watch in the night. So a watch in the night would be like the 3 to 4 hour watch in the night. It's, you know, so 1,000 years are kind of like 3 hours to you. And in fact, you know this. This is not something new. When for those of you who are like beyond like 35, can you remember high school? No. All you remember was like you went to prom once. He had a couple classes with somebody, and you have to go back to Facebook and kind of go back. Facebook didn't exist then. Okay, I have no idea. You don't even remember it. If you were to say, like, you remember stuff like the first handhold you had, just because there was like a synaptic response you had, like in fourth grade, and then you remember maybe the first kiss, or you know, you remember like massive events, or maybe you remember some traumatic events, maybe some great events, but that's about it. We forget a ton about our past. In fact, Moses says, you sweep them away as with a flood. They are like a dream. It's kind of like a dream, isn't it? Trying to remember high school, trying to remember middle school, trying to remember like how awkward you were and all the zits and stuff. I mean, that's awkward. And we just kind of want to keep moving. Like grass that is renewed in the morning. In the morning it flourishes and is renewed. In the evening it fades and withers. For we are brought to an end by your anger. And this is where you're kind of like, Moses, are you having a bad day? Do we need to like have a chat, put some counseling on? By your wrath, we are dismayed. Because we as Christians in our culture today, we don't like to hear about God's wrath. That makes God seem like he's upset at us. But here's the reality. We're sinners. And because we're sinners, we have a time limit on earth. Did you know that? All humans have a time limit on earth. Like, I'm not telling you anything new. Like, did you know, like, every one of us is terminal. Like, no one's thinking here, I'm going to live to, like, the year 2100. No one's thinking that. Well, maybe a couple of years. How about 2200? No, anyone think you're going to live to 2200? No, you're not. The reality is none of us are going to be around at the year 2200. Nobody. And so what we got to do with that is understand that there is a time limit. And I think some of us don't have this understanding. So when I was in Iraq, I had a 20-year-old who told me, sir, I'm too young to die. It's never going to happen. And 3 weeks later, he was dead. Shoot, if you've been a part of this church, a 40-year-old planted this church, and he passes away tragically. That was not planned for. My dad, 60s, One day, gone. He didn't give me like a goodbye speech. There was no like letter. I just wanted to thank you for being my awesome son. It was just over. 20s, 40s, 60s. You don't know when it is. This life is short. Is this making sense? I mean, I'm not telling you anything new. No one's like, oh my gosh, I was just planning on the cryogenic freeze my head, and then kind of next thing you know, it's like 2500 and I'm around. No, nobody, like that's not gonna happen. And here's the weird part about it. A lot of our life is spent voyeuristically watching other people's lives. Am I right? Like, we watch other people's lives on TV live their actual lives that we wish maybe we were living, but since we can't, we watch their life. So if you watch, anybody watch Gas Monkey Garage? A couple of you? Okay, yeah, there we go. All right, how about, you could just name a reality TV show. We are into it. My wife get calls to watch, like, bachelorette watching parties, like, all the time. Now, not that she goes. She wanted to make sure I said that she does not go. She does not go. She's been hardcore about it. But there's a lot of you guys watching a lot of other people's lives instead of actually living it. But that's just because we're, you know, there's something in us that we feel like we have an infinite life to live. And so we can kind of watch that life, kind of live in that life for a while. Because, you know, ultimately we'll get to live in our own life when we're older. But there is a time limit. You have a time limit. And if we could, like, you know, some people do this. They'll take it could be like something like this. They'll put a big bucket, and they'll take, every day they'll take out a ball, and you kind of look in, your time is getting smaller and smaller. And it shows you that there's a reality that you need to know that you don't get to live forever. All humans have a time limit. Okay, we got that. And then Moses is going to go on, and he's going to break it down. You have set our iniquities before you. So what that means is sin, iniquity, sin. Our secret sins in the light of your presence. So you know how, like, sometimes we feel like nobody will know about that. God knows. He knows about my secret stuff. We bring our years to an end like a sigh. And this is where you're like, man, this is getting kind of depressing. The years of our life are 70, or even by reason of strength, 80. And remember, Moses, when he's writing, this is 120. He's looking around. It's like, ain't too many guys, 120. They're all dying off at 80. Yet their span is but toil and trouble. They're soon gone, and we fly away. Which is, you know the song we sing, right? I'll fly away. Right here, that's where it comes from. Just in case you were wondering, this is where you learned that today. Psalm 90 is where we get the song, I'll Fly Away. All right. But here's it. There's something in us that we have this, like, limited time on the planet, but here's the good news for us. Here's the good news. We have limitless access to God in eternity. Because of our sin, we have a limited time here on earth. So just in case you don't know the whole story, human beings are sinful. Did you guys know that? All right, so at home, I have a 2-year-old and I have a 8-month-old. And the 2-year-old is really adept, you know, with gross motor skills, and he likes to show them off. So every now and then, I'll hear the baby start crying, and then I'll turn around, Austin's going, and I'm like, that's weird. And then he'll go, baby troubles. And I'm like, aw, Austin, you're so sweet. Can you give the baby a kiss? He'll go, and then, you know, we'll give the baby a kiss, calm the baby down, and then I'll turn away, and then I'll look back just for a sec, and then Austin's like, boom, and he's just punching him in the face. And then he'll look at me and go, baby troubles. I'm sure that doesn't happen at your house, but it does happen at ours, right? So you're just like, what in you makes you want to punch him in the face? Baby's got troubles. He's a sinner. I didn't have to teach him that. I didn't set Jet down and be like, this is a cross. Like, you get here and you want to have a twist. It's all in the torso. Like, that's where your power and your legs. Boom! All right, he just did it on his own. But here's the reality. Like, the difference between the 2-year-old who punches you in the face is not much from the 35-year-old who stabs you in the back. Right? We grow up sinners and we keep sinning. And so because of that issue, we have the separation from God that, like, God doesn't want the stab you in the back people in heaven with him. He's just like, that's not my kind of people. In fact, there's a separation between us and God because of our sinful nature. All of our sins are before God. It's not like he's like going, don't worry about it. God takes sin seriously. Sin cannot be in heaven. And so what he did is he sent his son Jesus, and he died on the cross. And he took the punishment for sin that you deserve and I deserve for us. Isn't that incredible? He that knew no sin became sin on our behalf so that we might be the righteousness of God. How cool is that? In fact, it wasn't because he was kind of bored or like he was like, nothing real is going on in heaven. It's because the only thing that Jesus lacked before going to the cross was you. So the Bible says, for the joy set before him, he endured the cross, despising its shame. You are the joy that was set before him. You are the thing he didn't have before the cross. And so God demonstrated his love for us in this, that while we were still sinners, still just a mess, Christ goes to the cross, he dies, and then he's raised from the dead. So anybody who wants forgiveness and freedom and joy and a relationship with God can have it. Isn't that awesome? And so that's the cool thing. Like, we have limitless access to God in eternity, because here's the truth of it. We are souls with a body, not a body with a soul. Did you know that? We're souls with a body, not a body with a soul. So no matter what, when your body like is buried in the ground and maybe becomes ash or something, you cremate it and, you know, you put it in an urn somewhere in your house and be like, you know, whatever. Ultimately, what happens here is that if you're a Christian, to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. Okay, so here's the cool part about that. Like, there's instant access to God, and it's an eternal access to God beyond this moment. But even if you don't accept Christ, your soul still lives on, and it's not a happy time. So why am I, man, this is like, I thought we were talking about neighboring and like loving our neighbor. We kind of went into the hell thing and heaven thing, and that makes me uncomfortable. I get it. But the reason why it should make you uncomfortable, because it's true. And here's the reality of it. Here's the reality of it. Your neighbors live next door to you for a reason. Your neighbors live next door to you for a reason. In fact, I'll prove it to you. There's an actual reason that you live right where. In fact, you already know this. How many of you guys got married and it was like this weird set of circumstances of how you guys met? And you go, it was only because of God. Right? Only, okay, thanks, Ben. You're my one, only you. Okay, cool. But the rest of you is like, you know, you're like, oh yeah, your parents arranged your marriage. And you're like, of course, that's who I'm going to marry. I understand. But for Ben and me, like, it was like the craziest set of circumstances that Adrian and I got together. It could have only been God. All right, so this is the way it worked. And so I'm gonna submit to you that you live where you live because God has a purpose for it. Watch this. Acts 17 proves this. And he made from one man every nation of mankind to live on all the earth, all the face of the earth, having determined allotted periods and the boundaries of their dwelling place, that they should seek God. I live where I live so that these people might know about God. Now, it works out that Jeff and Cassie, Jackson and Bethany, are here today. Hey, guys. All right, that works out. And it also works out that Paul and Liz were at first service. Okay, so two knocked out. Didn't you have to work for those? So that kind of works out that we got two people from our church. But all the rest of these don't go to our church, and I don't know where they're at spiritually. I don't know if their relationship with Jesus is. And so, and this is, you know, this is why I kind of filled this thing out, and it was super intentional over the summer. I was like, Adrian, I gotta know who these people are. So let's walk around the block 100 times because I'm about to, you know, hopefully they'll come out and we'll be awkward and I'll push through it, and hopefully you can be there. You can do the talking. I don't like to order pizza. I've told you this. It's like, it's just terrifying for me. And I also, this is for free again. Like, I love talking to you guys at church, okay, because this is the home court advantage for me, okay? Like, I feel like I'm supposed to talk to you. Like, and so when I'm supposed to talk to you, I don't feel weird about talking to you. But when it's my neighbor and when we're on, like even territory, no longer home court advantage, it's like, I'll do this next week. You know, that's kind of how it works, all right? But I live where I live. God determined where I would live and for the amount of time that I would live so that the people next to me might seek God. How cool is that? So it's set up for me. It's not a coincidence that I live right where I live. Not one coincidence. I live here on purpose. But I think sometimes we forget that because the heaven and hell thing, we're like, that's kind of like, that's the awkward, you know, crazy drunk uncle that you don't like to talk about. But the reality is it's true. And that Christ came And he died on the cross for you, and he gave you this responsibility to love God and love people. And the greatest way you can love people is to let them know about your God. But how do we, listen, this is the part where it's like, Chris, I mean, who even thinks about that? That's exactly what Moses said. Who even considers the power of your anger and your wrath according to the fear of you? Nobody does. We live in first world America where things aren't pretty much always pretty good. And so he says this, listen, so teach us. Teach us to number our days that we may get a heart of wisdom. You see, Moses asked God to teach him to limit his time because his time was limited. You get this. We get this with money, right? When you have a limited budget, you budget your money. When you have limited space, you budget your space because even the garage, even though it's packed to the ceiling, it doesn't hold infinity. We got to budget our time. We got to limit our time. And have you guys ever heard, like, you've heard this example before. It's like where, you know, somebody has, like, you've got all these things you want to do, and there's, like, big rocks are, like, the super important things, and, like, the smaller rocks are, like, the things that are sort of important. And then, like, gravel is, like, all your, you know, Facebook and Netflix binging, right? And so what it is, like, if you put the big rocks in first, and then you put in the pedals, then you'll have time for all the Netflix binging you could possibly do, and everything fits. Well, the problem with that's a myth, because that's saying that Netflix binging doesn't take quite as much time as raising your child. Both are segments of time. So I'm gonna try and show it from a different perspective. Okay, we're gonna use a vase. And so we all have time, and time, one sense of time is equal to another sense of time. So my time with God, that takes time. That unit of time is probably, you know, I might take more of these units, but I have to spend time with my wife, Adrian, because that's kind of like, I have to spend time with God. I have to spend time with my wife. I love my wife. And then I've got to spend time with my son, Austin, and make sure he doesn't keep punching Jet in the face. Okay, I got to spend time with Jet to kind of help him, you know, recovery from, like, all the abuse he's taken from his older brother. I've got to, you know, I spend time with my D group, all right? Hey, Israel's birthday today. There he is. There, yeah, he's in my D group. All right, and listen, if you have no idea, you're like, D group, what's that? It's a discipleship group. There's four of us. We meet every week, and we get to know each other's lives, and we talk about our marriages, and we talk about life, and we try and love God and love people really well, and that takes time. All right, how about this? I have to go to work, and I know some of you think, Chris, don't you just show up on Sunday and do your thing and then go home? Pretty much. But for the rest of you people who have, like, real jobs and, like, you just can't just, you know, come up here and do a song and dance every week. No, of course I work. I go, and Adrian will tell you, it's like 12 hours a day. So 12 hours, okay, let's just put a couple more in there because that's a lot of time, all right? So 12 hours a day, we're working, you know, during the work week. And then there's First Monday prayer. That takes time, and I know all of you guys go to that. And then, listen, and when you have a two-year-old and an eight-month-old, you got to plan and count. You got to put this on your calendar for sex. That's just kind of, like, that just doesn't happen. Quick, he's sleeping. All right, like, that's kind of how it works. All right, and then fantasy football. Listen. Yeah. This is a priority that we... And by the way, I just destroyed Phil Kwan last week. Thank you very much. Nobody was as excited as I was about that, but that was a big day for me. All right, so then I got time with my community group. I've got to spend time serving and, like, you know, at church. So, like, for some of you, you know, this is kind of how you roll. You come to church for 45 minutes on Sunday. You come 15 minutes late. You leave 15 minutes early. Like, as soon as I'm done talking, you're out of here. I get it. And, like, so it's not really that much of a, but still, that's 45 minutes of your time. But for the rest of you, like, who serve, that's like 3 hours of your time. In fact, some of you are going to come to count me in today. Count me in. That's, like, our membership class, by the way. It's going to be in the portables, free lunch. Okay. So, like, you're going to come to count me in. That's going to take a whole hour and a half, like, maybe 2 hours of your time. You're going to have to hear some people talk at you, and you're going to talk with, meet new people. That's hard. And then there's birthdays. It's Israel's birthday today. All right. And, like, you don't forget, like, at our family, Adrian has a birth week. So that's another one that And then we've got, like, if you do sports, there's soccer. You got to do that. And then there's, like, baseball games. You got to go to those. And then there's date night. And then there's Christmas. All right, listen. This is free advice for all my single people. Where you guys at? All right, here we go. You figure out Christmas and Thanksgiving before you actually get engaged. Like, decide that ahead of time, all right? That will solve your life problems. All right, Thanksgiving, got to put that one in there. Okay, and then there's errands. Like, someone's got to change your oil. Might be you, but that's going to take some time. How about, you got to work out. You got to keep fit. You got to go on a men's retreat. You got to go on a women's retreat. You got to go golfing. And there's lots of video games we got to be playing. Maybe put two for video games. Then we got to walk the dog. That takes time. We got to mow the yard. Trust me, that takes a lot of time. And turns out, Adrian doesn't like it. I wanted to grow my hedges so high, it'd be like natural barriers. Huh? Anyway, that didn't fly. Okay, and then we got to organize the garage because of all the stuff we have in there. And then we got to play football when we're not watching football. And then we got to go fishing and hunting, and there's cooking and cleaning. And then there's cars that need to be cleaned out, and there's garages that need to be cleaned out. I've kind of hitting that one a couple times, huh? And then there's shopping. Okay, so then there's all these things. And then there's, like, here's Jeff and Cassie and Jackson and Bethany. I'll put them right there. Get in there. But then I've got all these other neighbors. I got all these neighbors. Here's Ken and Kim that live behind me. Here's Amr and his three boys. Here's BJ and Anju. And then here is Jonathan, my next door neighbor with Jurassic Park. And then here's Colonel and Joyce, right? Like, I've got all these sweet people. Here's Catherine. How cool is that? Catherine, is no longer with Amr, but she still hangs around. So anyway, what do I do? I don't have time. Because these, I can't just put in the important things first, and then, because all time is equal and it's all important. So what am I going to do? Because fantasy football and watching that, it might take a couple hours, and I've got to, really get into my team. But what if instead of watching fantasy football by myself, I watched it with Tim and Andrea and found out he was a football fan? How cool is that? All right, and what if instead of, having dinner by our little family, once a month we just called somebody and said, hey, Jonathan, I know you're a single guy and you probably eat, ramen noodles every day, so why don't you come over? And we'll talk about your lawn. Okay, and then there's Colonel and Joyce. And, there's already stuff I am doing. Why don't I have them come and join me? Do you guys kind of get the point here? I got to remove some stuff or combine some stuff, because the priority has got to be God called me to reach my neighbors. And he has put me here specifically to reach them. And if I don't do it, who is? Now, isn't the cool part that God is sovereign? God is in complete control of this, and so I don't feel like the weight of it. I feel the opportunity of it. And so I get to find a way to limit my time to include my neighbors. So here's what I want you to do. I want you to ask God to limit your time. And limiting is another word for budgeting. I want you to limit your time. In fact, did you know that God gave the people of Israel a day to do nothing, and they still managed to exist? How is that even possible? Because God knew that if he didn't limit the time of the people for him, they would fill it to the max, and their current pace of life would always be at the limit. And so what I want you to do is take your current pace of life down, and I want you to kind of put within it time for the people that are your neighbors and who God has called you to. Remember God's job description? Love the world. Your job description? Love your neighbor. How cool is that? God's job description? Love the whole world. Your job description? Love your neighbor. We need to limit our time so that we can love our neighbor. Now here's a fun thing. Remember Craig and Tasha? On October 6th, we are inviting our whole neighborhood to our house because it's National Night Out, right? National Night Out is like the time when it's not awkward to invite people over. And so if you're like me and you have to have an actual reason to invite people over because it's so weird to just randomly knock on somebody's door and be like, hey, I'm your neighbor and I don't know you and I need to, even though that'd be perfectly probably normal. So I've been texting all my neighbors that I have their phone numbers for, and the rest I have to actually go to their door, which is terrifying, but I'm going to have to do it. And I said, I'm just going to invite Craig. Why not? He lives North Georgetown now. And the one thing is, like, our neighbors never knew each other. And so I was like, here we go. Hey, Craig, we're having a thing to get to know our neighbors on October 6th. And I know that you don't live here anymore, but we still consider you a neighbor. Would you want to come to our house and have like a little barbecue, get to know our neighbor kind of thing? And he's like, absolutely. It was like almost too easy. I was expecting, he's like, no, I'm busy. He's not busy. He wanted to have time with me. And what's going to happen from that? I'm hoping that even though he lives in North Georgetown, that one day he'll make his way down here, or maybe he'll find a local church, or maybe he'll learn this thing of neighboring, or maybe he'll move back, you know, I don't know. But this is a start. God is giving you this time, this period of time, in this particular location for a reason. Let's ask God to know our neighbor. Maybe here's, how are you going to get him over for dinner? It's overwhelming. If you don't plan, it's overwhelming. In fact, if somebody here today asks me to have coffee or lunch, I will say absolutely. If I do not pull out my phone in that moment and put on the calendar, you know what's going to happen. Nothing. It's not going to happen. And so we've got to put it on the calendar. Here, how about this? Put some months up there for you. I don't know. Maybe on your Who Is My Neighbor sheet, you're going to write in, okay, October, here we go. I'm inviting that neighbor over for dinner. As awkward and as weird as it seems, you invite him. And then November, then December, and then January, and then February, then March, then April, then May. That's 8 months. You got 8 neighbors. Okay, maybe you have less than that. Maybe you have a cul-de-sac. I don't know what you got, but you got it. What would happen if we did that? Remember, there's 250,000 Christians in Austin. And if we reached out to the 8 neighbors that we have, we could change Austin. We could reach them with the life-changing reality of Jesus Christ so that their sins could be forgiven. That they could have eternal life with God. Because it all started with an awkward but necessary knock on the door. Hey, how you doing? Can I walk my dog with you? Whatever that looks like. Would you pray with me? Father, I'm asking, I'm hoping, I'm begging, I'm pleading. I'm saying, please, God, would you do the thing that you do that would already prepare our neighbors? Because you're in control of this. You actually put us where we live for a reason, God. And Lord, when we text or when we knock, would you go before and take the awkwardness out of the conversation just for my sake, please, because it's going to happen really soon and I'm sort of terrified. So please, God, would you do that for me as I go over to somebody's house and I say, hey, I want to get to know you. I want to know your name. I want to know your birthday. I want to know what's going on in your life because I've been called to love you. God, would you help me to do that? Even when I don't feel like it, would you help me to limit my time? Because my time is limited so that when I go to my neighbor, I don't feel busy. And my neighbor doesn't look at me as too busy for him or her. And God, I pray that somebody here that maybe for the first time they've kind of understood that Jesus died on the cross for them, and they're put here, right here in this service this Sunday morning, and for the specific reason of hearing that God loves you and he sent his son to die for you and experience hell for you. God, I'm praying that they would hear that and they would believe on the resurrection of Jesus, that they could have eternal life with you. Please, God, would you open up their heart? And Lord, for those of us who know that and believe that, would you give us the courage? Would you give us your courage and your vision just to simply know our neighbor's name, to invite our neighbor over, to have a relationship and do life with our neighbors. We love you, God. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. This is all about reaching our neighbors. Because God's job description is what? Love the world. Our job description, love our neighbor. If you want to partner with us and being kind of an ambassador for this church to reach Wells Branch and the greater Austin area. It's a life changer out of Jesus Christ. We have our count me in class like in like 20 minutes from now. Everyone look at Ben. Everyone look that way. That is Ben. Ben will be leading that class. Follow him to the portables and you can find out what it is to be a member here to reach people with a life changer out of Jesus Christ. We're pretty excited about that. Now imagine what would happen if we lived this out and love your neighbor wasn't some conceptual thing of some random person that you would randomly see, but it was an intentional thing that happened because you limited your time. Because we know we have a limited time. Our neighbors would be impacted. Our schedules would actually be clearer and more intentionally lived. And our families would understand what we're here for. Would you receive the benediction? Go. And know your neighbor's name. Invite your neighbor over to dinner. Love your neighbor well because you've been loved by a God who sent his son Jesus to die for you so you can have an incredible relationship with him. So go, push back that darkness, meet your neighbors, and have an awesome week of worship.